هيا على الفلاح.
So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned a dream that he had seen. And the hadith is mentioned in Bukhari and Muslim. He says that I saw in my dream that I was given two bangles of gold. And as soon as they were as gold, the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, I disliked them, I hated them. He says, and then I was revealed, or it was revealed to me to blow upon them. He says, and as soon as I blew on them, they disappeared. Then he says, I did ta'wil, tafsir of the manam of two fake claimers of prophecy that will come. And he mentioned them by name, Al-Aswad Al-Ansi and Musaylam Al-Kadhab. And they both appeared in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Al-Aswad Al-Ansi, his name, or he is a man who is from Yemen, from a great tribe in Yemen. And Al-Aswad Al-Ansi, when the people of Yemen entered into Islam, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he spoke highly of the people of Yemen. Before the Islam of Yemen, who did they used to follow? They used to follow Kisra. It was always changing between the Romans and between the Persians. At the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it was in the hands of the Persians. And when the news came out of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the leader of the Persians sent to his worker in Yemen, he sent him a message telling him to go to the Prophet ﷺ and bring him to me in cuffs. He has to come to me as a prisoner. So this man, following the orders of to him who is the greatest person alive, the leader of the Persians, he sends a messenger to the Prophet ﷺ. And this messenger, he comes to the Prophet ﷺ and he says that the leader of Persia, he wants you to go to him as a prisoner. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, okay, come here. He says, your leader in Persia has died. Go back to your man, tell him to enter into Islam. Your leader in Yemen, tell him to enter into Islam. For your leader has passed away. And tell him that there's no way, yani, there's no way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to take himself as a prisoner to Persia, to the leader of Persia. So this man, this messenger, he goes back to his leader Badhan in Yemen, and he mentions to him that which he has said. As soon as he heard that and the news had come, the leader of Yemen, Badhan, he accepted Islam. He knew that this, yani, this can only be wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the people who were there entered into Islam. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he kept him as the wali of Yemen to show gratitude to this man, Badhan. After the death of Badhan, he didn't live long after he entered into Islam. After he passed away, the Prophet ﷺ, he appointed his son in his position or in his place. Nabi ﷺ was wise. He knew how to deal with the different tribes. Nabi ﷺ, he sent some of the best Sahaba to Yemen to teach them the deen. The first, or from the first people he sent, was Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu. He sent Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, Khalid ibn Sa'id ibn al-As. He sent many Sahaba who went and they taught the people of Yemen, and the people of Yemen, they entered into Islam. After the Hajjat al-Wada' of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we mentioned, he became sick, and a man appeared now who is al-Aswad al-Ansi. And he proclaimed, or he claimed for himself, prophecy. His name is Abhala ibn Ka'b ibn Ghawth. And he used to be in a cave, which is called Kahf Khubban, which is in Yemen. And he used to be a sorcerer. He used to be a person who deals with black magic, who deals with the jinn. And when he heard of the prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and when he heard of the strength and of the tribes, the year of delegations, where all the Arab tribes came to the Prophet ﷺ, and all of Arabia accepted the leadership of the Prophet ﷺ. So when he saw this, he became thirsty with leadership. Greediness came into his heart, wanting that which the other people want. So when he looked at the Prophet ﷺ, and after seeing that his prophecy is that which gave him strength, he went and what? claimed prophecy to himself. So the first people he went to his people, his own tribe. They followed him, they accepted him. And then he went to Najran, and Najran entered with him. And then he went to Murad, and Murad entered to him. Now the last place that is left is Sana'a, which is the center of the Muslims, which is where the wali of the Muslims is. When Shahr bin Badhan, the son of Badhan, the wali of Sana'a, when he heard about Al-Aswad Al-Ansi, he gathered his army and he went out to face him. But unfortunately, he wasn't able to face him. The army of the Muslims lost, and Shahr bin Badhan was martyred in that battle. So the majority of Yemen now had followed in the footsteps, or had followed Al-Aswad Al-Ansi and believed in him, and all of this is now is happening, and the Prophet ﷺ is still alive. Abu Musa Al-Ash'ari, Mu'adh bin Jabal, they left Sana'a and they went towards Hadramaut. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, now he's given importance to the situation that has taken place with Al-Aswad Al-Ansi. And there were people who were in Sana'a who stayed there even after Al-Aswad Al-Ansi had entered. They stayed there and they concealed, or they took the position of Taqiyyah, which means that they openly showed the following of Al-Aswad Al-Ansi and they concealed the Iman, opposite to the Munafiqeen. The Munafiqeen, they show the Iman and they conceal Kufr. The people that were there in Yemen, in Sana'a at that time, the Persians, they were known as Al-Abna, which is the sons. They were the children, or from the offsprings of the Persians. They were Persians, they were not Arabs. They were in Yemen. Yemen is Arab. But they were Persians, so they were known as Al-Abna. And the Persians, subhanAllah, the Persians who were there, who were Muslims, they were the ones who stood firm the most. A lot of the Arab tribes, especially the big Arab tribes in Yemen, they had all went with Al-Aswad Al-Ansi. The Persians, the ones who accepted Islam, and they were non-Arabs, they stood firm. And they stood firm against Al-Aswad Al-Ansi. And they gathered together, plotting and planning how they're going to take out Al-Aswad Al-Ansi. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he sent out letters to Mu'adh bin Jabal, to Abu Musa Al-Ash'ari, to the Sahaba who were around at that time, to gather the armies and to do an attack, or to raise an attack upon Al-Aswad Al-Ansi. The Persians, Al-Abna, who were in Sana'a at that time, they said to Mu'adh, give us some time, we will be able to get rid of him without a war. And from those who plotted with the Muslims was the leader of the armies of Al-Aswad Al-Ansi. The leader of his army plotted with them on how to get rid of him, because he mistreated, or was mistreating, his leader. So the first thing that came, or the first opportunity he saw of getting rid of his leader, he joined in with the Muslims. And there were four men, four Muslimin, who plotted, or they put the plan together, how are they going to get rid of Al-Aswad Al-Ansi. And when every time they would gather, Al-Aswad Al-Ansi, he was a musha'wadh. He was a person of black magic. He used to deal with jinn. Every time they would gather together, Al-Aswad Al-Ansi, he would call his leader and tell him that the wahi came to me. And it told me that the four of yous gathered and that yous are plotting and planning. And he mentioned all of their names. So when they saw, the door was closed in front of them. And when they saw, after one of them heard Al-Aswad Al-Ansi saying to one of his followers that tonight I am going to kill him, now the Persians who were in Sana'a, they said, khalas, now we have to get rid of him. And Azad, the wife of Al-Aswad Al-Ansi, her family members were amongst the Muslims who were plotting to kill him. So one of the followers, one of her cousins, he approached her and he told her that we need your help to get rid of Al-Aswad Al-Ansi. And that's how the plan was put together. And on that same night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he opened the doors in front of them. And on that same night, they were able to kill Al-Aswad Al-Ansi through the help of his wife, Azad. The one who, she says, I have not seen anyone who is more further away from the deen than this person, who is more committing of the haram than this person. In a situation which is very hard, anything I can do to get rid of this person, I will do. So she put her own life in risk. The people, they no longer follow that person. And the Muslim army entered, and Al-Yemen and Sana'a was back to Islam, but the story with Yemen and Sana'a doesn't end there. After the Prophet ﷺ had appointed a new leader and a new wali on Sana'a and on Yemen, and then after his death, the second war of Ridda against the people of Yemen began in the time or in the Khilafah of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he appointed Fayruz al-Daylami, who was from the Abna. Originally, they were Persian. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he appointed him as the wali of Sana'a, which was at that time one of the greatest cities that was around in Yemen. And that didn't sit well with the ex-general of Al-Aswad Al-Ansi, who was Qais ibn Abd Yaghuth, because I was the general. I am the man who has the power. I am the man who has the followings. And it was from the policies of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu that he didn't appoint any of the Murtaddeen in positions of power. He was the general of Al-Aswad Al-Ansi. And he followed Al-Aswad Al-Ansi until he returned. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he guided him back to Islam. But it was the policies of Abu Bakr that anyone who, even if it was for a day, committed ridda, that's it. He never appoints them in position of leadership. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he makes a genius plan. And he break up the large army of the Muslimin to 11 different armies to fight those who had left the deen and those who had apostated out of Islam. The first of those armies was the army of the great Sahabi Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu. So first he was going to the tribe of Tay, and then to Bani Asad, where Tulayha ibn Khuwaylid al-Asdi was, and then to Bani Tamim, and in the Malik ibn Nuwayra, until he reached Bani Hanifa. After the victory of Musaylam al-Kadhab, which was the fifth army, the sixth army that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he sent out during the wars of apostasy, was to the edges of Asham, which is now Jordan. And he had sent on the head of that army the great Sahabi Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, and his son, who is known also with him, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhuma. When they reached, they didn't face any fighting. And the tribes, after hearing of the victories of the Muslimin, they didn't face off with the armies of the Muslimin. Rather, they came back to Islam and they entered into Islam. The seventh army that was sent out by Abu Bakr was sent to Al-Bahrain. Al-Ala ibn al-Hadrami was sent to Al-Bahrain, which is on the other side of the Arabian Peninsula. And he has this army with him, which is no less than 2,000-3,000 men. He's covering a distance in some of the harshest temperatures. And the tribes that he was going to were the tribes of Abdul Qais, which were known tribes in Arabia. And he stopped there in a place called Hajar. And the tribes in that area that he had reached, they were all had apostatized from Islam. And on the head of them, their biggest tribe, which was Abdul Qais. And only a small village, which was called Juwatha, had stayed upon Islam. And the Murtaddeen, they had surrounded it. And they didn't leave them alone. Fal'ala ibn al-Hadrami radiallahu anhu, he followed the strategy of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, where he started to send out letters to the different tribes to see which of the tribes had stayed upon Islam and to see which of the tribes, the smaller tribes, are in need of help, in which they can, the army of the Muslimin can help them, and then in return they can join the army of the Muslimin. And the first message that was sent to a tribe called Tamim, and they returned to Islam, and 1,000 fighters had joined the army of Al-Ala ibn al-Hadrami just from that one tribe. And Thumam ibn Athal also came with 1,000 more men. And one of the other tribes was able to escape from the armies and join with the Muslimin. Because as we mentioned before, not every single member of all the tribes had left Islam. The leaders are the ones who didn't want to pay the zakat. The leaders are the ones who didn't want to follow Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And the army or the army of the Muslimin increased. And the battle began between Ala ibn al-Hadrami and the tribe of Abdul Qais. And the battle went on for a whole month. And each one of them had dug a trench between each other. And it is known that in the time of warfare that they fight during the day, and then during the night, each person returns to their camp. The Muslimin, they return to their camps and they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give them victory. The army of the Murtaddin, Al-Ala ibn al-Hadrami radiallahu anhu, he hears loud noises coming from the tents in the camp of the Murtaddin. The loud noise was the noise of those or the people in the camp, in the campsite getting drunk and playing music and having fun and singing and doing all of this during the night. So Al-Ala ibn al-Hadrami, he said, this is the time to attack. And after Al-Ala ibn al-Hadrami, he went and he attacked them, he was able to take over the campsite and to win the battle. The 8th and the 9th army that took place were sent to Uman. After the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, a man came up by the name of Laqit ibn Malik, and he also claimed prophecy because they saw the strength that the Prophet ﷺ, he gained through his prophecy. And Laqit ibn Malik, he took over the whole of Uman. When Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he knew about this or that this was taking place, he sent two armies. The first by the leadership of Hudhayfa ibn Muhsan, and the other army by the leadership of Urfuja ibn Hurthuma radiallahu anhuma. And he told them to join together and to go under the leadership of Hudhayfa ibn Muhsan. And followed them was Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl radiallahu anhu, after he was defeated in front of Musaylama and before he went back. Until they continued to fight until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through his mercy, Al-Ala ibn al-Hadrami radiallahu anhu, who we just mentioned previously, he was in Bahrain, which is not far from Oman. After he had finished from Al-Bahrain, he joined Hudhayfa ibn Muhsan. And when he joined Hudhayfa ibn Muhsan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he opened or he gave the victory to the Muslimin after they continuously fought. And then the three armies, they joined together and they cleaned that area, or they swept through that area, and they were able to bring it back to Islam. The 10th and the 11th army are the armies that we have talked about in the beginning of the wars of apostasy, which were the armies that dealt with the apostasy of Al-Aswad Al-Ansi in Sana'a and in Yemen. And in this way, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he was able to stabilize the Arabian Peninsula. And he was able to make sure that all the tribes around him were not forcibly entered into Islam, that they had all returned to the true faith, and the faith that they had entered into willingly, they all came back willingly and entered into Islam by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this was how Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he was able to take control of Jazirat al-Arab and to take control of the Muslimin and to give the Muslimin the strength that it had during the days of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam.